vibración musical colombiana. Hoy le queremos dar para el perro, para la perra, para el abuelo, para la abuela, para toda la gente que quiere bailar.
¿Cuál es el punto? El asunto está corrupto. Vida dedicado al falso contaminado y encaminado a los campos minados. Sede que gobiernan y controlan nuestra tierra hipnotizada.
I'm ready. You are. Oh, it is Friday, baby. And you can feel it with the music.
There we are. There we are.
You ready there?
Not really. Hold on.
You struggling today?
I'm struggling today. It's Friday, Fonzie. It's Friday. Here we go. Here we go.
And we are ending the week with a bang.
We are ending the week with a bang. What's up?
What is up, everyone?
Happy Friday, peeps. Happy Friday. With this is our favorite part of the day. I love ending the work week like this.
I know. It's so incredible to have amazing guests. Ooh. And amazing conversations.
Oh, yeah.
To end the week with.
I know. We've been, so we're just like behind cameras a little bit. We're chatting how we've been on meetings, calls all day, and we're ending with a bang. And I love it because I've interacted a little bit here and there with our guests, and I think she is ready to bring so much value. Fonzie here.
I'm just gonna stand here and stare at the camera.
Yeah, he's just gonna
smile.
Yeah,
I'm actually very excited because you have talked very highly about today's guest. I know very little about today's guest besides the fact that she is absolutely amazing. So we're gonna have to dig a little deeper in there.
All right. With that said, guys, let's dive into the show. Here we go.
Oh, by the way.
No, don't say anything.
Today's intro was written by my brother.
Oh, man. Okay.
Let's go. Let's see how that's
going. Pressure is on. Here we go. Okay. I see our guest smiling. Let's see if she's still smiling after the intro. Here we go. All right. Here we go.
We've got some fresh
and I'm Fonzie.
And you're listening to the Content Is Profit podcast.
And we spent the last 4 years learning the strategies and techniques from some of the top marketers in the world on how to create content that turns you into profit.
If you'd like to learn more how to turn that content into profit, go to contentisprofit.com. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. And today we're talking all about how to make marriage and business your superpower.
Together.
Wow.
Integrate perfectly.
Wow.
It's so good.
I'm not married, but I'm super excited.
But you are
for
in
this
a relationship.
I am in a relationship.
And you will be married at some point, Fonzie.
At some point, yes. Yeah. Indeed. So
Mandy, I'm playing for you over here.
That's why I have my notes out here. I'm gonna be taking notes intently today.
I know. Fonzie, do we have a sponsor today?
Indeed we do, and thank you for asking.
You're
good,
welcome,
sir. And today's sponsor is your one and only The Biz Bros with Content Momentum. And yes, we are sponsoring our own show.
Yeah, surprise, surprise.
And you might be asking yourself, what is Content Momentum? Well, if you produce a long form piece of content just like this one that you're listening to or watching, and you want to turn it into value packed bite sized assets so then you can send them to the world and amplify your contribution. Listen there, not the noise, but the contribution.
That's
then
right,
we want
right.
to help you out. We want to turn those long pieces of content and distill the golden boulders,
baby,
and give them back to you so you can share them with the world. If you're interested, slide in the DMs. On Instagram and Facebook at BizBusco.
Or LinkedIn too.
We're official and on LinkedIn where you might see us all well dressed and whatnot.
Please do us a favor and go ahead and subscribe. Hit smash that subscribe button because those episodes are dropping on your phone every Tuesday, Thursdays, and Saturdays. And follow us on social media at BizBusco for the latest updates and golden boulders.
That's right. And if you find this episode impactful, which I am sure you will, please, or ask is to share it. Share it with someone that you think this message will resonate and will help them. So please share the episode and don't forget to give us a 5-star review. Thank you.
Well, here we go. I'm so excited to bring you guys today's guest. We met her through our mutual friends, Corey and Ron from Highland Hacking. She was part of an insane 10-hour live stream that we also participated in. So logically, we had to reach out and connect.
She is currently helping passionate entrepreneurs who are building and scaling businesses, stay happily married by unveiling their commitment, communication, and connection skills. Wow. I think this is perfect for you, bro.
I know.
Her show On the Brighter Side ranked number 4 in the relationships category.
On iTunes. Woo. Yeah.
We got a superstar.
Complete epicness here. Other than improving and changing lives, she has also interviewed Russell Branson. She is fluent in English and Spanish, an incredible mother of 4 amazing kiddos.
I did not know she was fluent in Spanish. Wow, that is pretty impressive.
I know.
Please welcome On the Brighter Side host, incredible coach, and our Arepa party host, Monica Tanner. Welcome, Monica.
Thank you so much, guys. That was awesome.
Surprise, surprise, surprise. Good surprise or bad surprise?
Great surprise. Should we hablamos en español or inglés?
Definitely español today.
Yeah.
We'll have this in the background.
Yeah, we can do a Spanglish episode.
For those listening and be like, I have no idea what Luis is or Monica talking about. You know, before cameras, I told him, like, have you heard or seen any of the episodes? And she was like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. No, but like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You know why? Because it's better reaction that way when we introduce you guys. And that's the truth of why we asked that question. So now you lived it. So now you have to go share it with other people, Monica. Just saying. again, incredible. Honestly, I'm so excited to have you here because I feel like what you preach and you talk on your show and with your people, and I've been in several sessions now with you, is because it's legit helping me and my relationship. That's what I'm going to say. And obviously, you publish a ton. You have more than 200 episodes in your show, and we need to bring this to the light. And you know, more people need to know this. But for those who don't know you, Monica, why don't you tell us a little bit about who you are? How do you start it? Why this whole, you know, sex espionage thing started? And Ponce is like, I have no idea what he's talking about. So
I'm here to learn with everybody. I'm so excited.
Yeah. So where to start? Goodness. Well, like you introduced, my name is Monica Tanner. I am wife to a hunky man. Who only knows pest control terms in Spanish because he has sold pest control in Texas and Georgia and all those southern states, as well as here where we live in Idaho and California. So he has to know bug names in Spanish. But other than that, he knows no Spanish.
He probably knows more bug names in Spanish than we do. I will assure you.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does. But we have 4 children, and so that keeps life very busy. 2 of them are teenagers. 2 of them are preteens. They are so much fun. I am a relationship and intimacy expert, and also, like you said, host of On the Brighter Side, Marriage for Entrepreneurs. And that started about 3 years ago when, I'll back up just a little bit. So when my youngest of those 4 went to school full time, like first grade, I decided I was going to go to school as well to become a marriage and family counselor because I was super passionate about helping married people stay happily married. And what happened was I got about a year into that program and I decided that there was no way, no how I wanted to be a therapist. Nothing against therapists. I think they're super important, but I just did not want to wait to help people until they were feeling like their last straw, right? And so I wanted to help couples stay out of the therapy office. So what happened was I dropped out of the program because I knew that was the right thing to do, but I got super depressed because I was like, how am I going to help people? Who's going to listen to me? I don't have any letters behind my name, no big qualifications. I know what I'm talking about, but I don't have like the papers to prove it, right? And so lucky enough for me, Russell Brunson is my neighbor. He is a wonderful friend. And he came over to check on our family one day and I told him my struggle. At the time, I didn't know who he was or what he really did. I mean, I knew him as a great guy, but I didn't know what he did for a living, right? And so yeah. I'm telling him this story.
You met like Bruce Wayne. You knew Bruce Wayne, but you didn't know Batman.
That's it. And so I'm telling him this story about how I wanted to help married people, but I just didn't know how to get my message out. And Russell was like, you need to start a podcast. And I was like, what? I would have no idea how to do that. He's like, I will help you. I will send you an email with everything you need to know. And I was like, in the back of my head, I was like, yeah, right. He's not really going to do that. But he did. So he went up that same day, actually, because I was like, I want to write a book. I want to help people. I want to do all these things, but I don't know who's ever going to listen to me. And so in that same conversation, he went out to his car and he brought me back a copy of Expert Secrets. And he said, look, I don't have any letters behind my name. And he goes, this book is all about marketing. And did you know that I actually got a C in my college marketing class? And I was like, what? And he goes, but I've been doing it for a really long time. And therefore, I can talk about it with authority. And I was like, okay, well, I've been married for 15 years. So can I talk about that with authority? And he goes, yes, you can. So that's kind of my origin story, how I got started. 3 years ago, I started On the Brighter Side and I had no clue what I was doing. And I remember Russell saying, just start talking and you will find your voice. So blindly, that's what I did. And it's been an incredible 3 years. I've had the opportunity to help lots of people and it's just been absolutely amazing.
Wow. Super inspiring. By the way, I think like everybody in the audience is super jealous of you just having Russell as a neighbor. But that's too incredible. You know, I mean, that obviously says a lot about him, but more probably about you because I think that was the permission that you needed to be like, okay, I can talk about this, right? Sometimes as entrepreneurs or starting to publish, we doubt ourselves because we might think that we need to achieve another level four, right? And I relate so much to your story because we were in that spot when we first started publishing. Like we're like, should we even talk about this? Like, how do we talk about this, right? And what framework do we have to come up to talk about this stuff? Like from before the show on our 45 Live and, you know, what am I even going to say, right? So I commend you from starting an incredible journey. And, you know, I'm more curious later, probably we'll talk a little bit about your publishing journey and how has that evolved and so on. But the first point there is like, we got to get started just like you did. And look how happy you look now. You're like, you have this smile from like ear to ear. And you're like, yes, I'm going to never stop doing this.
Yeah, it's true.
Something that, you know, that comes out of that message that you just shared is the fact that you didn't want to wait to help people, right? And you don't want people to be at their last resort before coming, you know, before getting help. It's like, how can I avoid that problem? How can I help people avoid that? Yeah. And what comes to mind is like, I'm curious on how do you come to this realization? Because, you know, we live in a world where everything is so structured in the education world, right? It's like, yeah, you got to take these courses and you got to get your diploma. Like you said, the letters before or after your name, I don't know either. But how, you know, what does it take to actually say, I'm going to step out of this, right? And build my own thing and create my own thing? Because a lot of people might be struggling now too with not just the education system, but now there's a lot of voices and a lot of authority out there. And they might be thinking to themselves, okay, I need to finish taking these courses or right, starting under certain mentor before I can actually take action and start helping people. So how do you become action driven, if you want to put it that way, instead of, you know, following a path and then waiting to see if you will get there?
You know, that's really interesting the way you said path. So I'll share something with you because at the beginning, I remember Russell was checking on me. He's like, so how's your podcast going? And I'm like, well, it's going. I don't think it's very good. And he goes, that's okay. Nobody's listening to you right now anyways. And I was like, okay, good. I'll keep going. But I actually, this is really interesting. I was just chatting with him last night. And I was like, do you know what this is like? This whole journey has been like for me. I was like, I feel like you took me to the beginning of a path. Like you set me on this path and you gave me this backpack with all of these tools in it, right? And you were like, all right, go get to the top of the mountain. And I was like, okay. And I just started going and I had no idea where I was going. And I would get to like a challenge or like a point where I'd be like, okay, I'm not sure what to do. And so I'd look in my backpack and for a long time, I was like, I don't really know what's in here or how to use any of it, right? Because yeah. It was all, I mean, it was like a lot of marketing stuff and some like really cool things. You know, I had all of his trainings that he sent me and stuff, but I would watch him and be like, I don't really get this, right? And I just had to keep going. Even in the dark and even when it was hard, I just kind of kept walking and kept going on the path. And sometimes the path would get really like questionable, like, oh, I'm not sure which way, there'd be forks in the road, things like that, right? But now I'm really, really starting to understand some of the tools in my backpack. Like now I'm like, oh, I get it now. Like I've trialed and erred and like done some different programs and courses and like figured things out. And so now I can look at my backpack and be like, oh, I get how that works now. A high ticket coaching program. Oh, okay. I can make that work with my stuff. So I've never felt, I've never questioned the content that I provide, like the different frameworks that I've created and the ways in which I help people. It's the marketing that's always been like the scary path. Like, I'm not really sure how this works, right? But now I'm starting to understand it. So you're right. There's tons of voices. There's tons of mentors. There's tons of people out there talking about how to do this or how to do that. And I think it's a matter of you just have to follow your gut. And you have to try some things. Not everything's going to work for everyone. And you just kind of make it up as you go.
Absolutely. Awesome. I love how you said you never questioned your message, right? And that is so important because I feel like a lot of people, and it takes time, right? And to build confidence and to be able to share your message, we're afraid a lot of the time, right? To get in front of the camera or front of the microphone and actually speak what we believe in. But like you said, I was never afraid of sharing it. And I believe 100% in my message. That is so, so, so important because at the end of the day, the tools is not what makes an entrepreneur, right? The entrepreneur just leverages those tools to build whatever they're going to go and build. So, I mean, I can tell since the beginning, you are 100% focused and dedicated to that one message, which is a huge lesson, right? I want to invite those that are listening to ask themselves, am I committed to my message the way Monica is committed to her message, right? Because it is an important point to ask. I'm going to be honest, when we first started doing content, right? We came from doing what we called, I'm doing our quotes here, the anti-marketing agency, which we would just go to any other business and ask them what were they frustrated with. And we were like, we can do that better than the other person, right? And we didn't actually believe in what we were doing. And once we transitioned to content, it started a little rocky, if I'm being honest. I didn't 100% believe, but the more I was doing it and take action, now I can say with total certainty, I'm like, I 120% believe in our message, right? That we share every single day.
It was funny, Monica, because, you know, right now our business literally is 100% content, right? And when we first started with the agency, it was 7 different things. And I remember coming into the office and we had the whiteboard and we literally drew like every process that we did. And it was like kind of like if you put them all together, it will make an amazing, amazing product. But we weren't executing all together with one client. It was like one with one, the second one with another one. And, you know, it was our learning phase. It was the dark times and, you know, lots of learning, lots of frustration, lots of crying in the background for Fonzie, you know, people go on the desk and just like, and experimenting, right? Like you said, like for you, it was like, I'm testing my message. I'm sure that I want to help people. Like for us, we're like, we're sure we want to help people. We're sure we want to do the business. We don't really know like where we fit, right? And through execution, we kind of found that. And I remember sitting, I'm like, okay, Fonzie, why do people keep asking us, right? And that's one of the lessons like on marketing, you got to listen to your clients, to your audience. And everybody's like, content, 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 right? And he's like, no, but I'm not sure, man. I want to do like, email marketing and blah, 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 and all the stuff that doesn't really matter right now. But that was like a very strong like discussion there. And for days, we were trying to figure out, okay, what's the path? Like, where I'm meeting to, right? And I feel like some people starting their businesses, that might be a struggle to do that. So the fact that you, from day one, you were very clear, and you remind me so much of Ayelet, right? Like she, for those familiar with the ClickFunnels community, she came in and she's like, man, I'm so passionate. I also don't want to wait to like the end to help people like in struggle. She was like, at the same time, it's like, I want to help one too many. Like I want to make a big impact. And you had that same fire or even more sometimes. And you're like, man, I'm sure about my message. So now this is how I get my message out there. So thank you for helping us. What is a tip maybe for those that might not have that clarity from the very beginning? Like, what would you say to them?
Yeah, so like I said, I knew the experience that I had, and I knew the things that I learned in my marriage, like building a business with my husband and then leaving the business and then starting a different business and then selling that business because it was too much for our family and then starting a new business. Like I know my experience and the things that I've learned, but I didn't know like, will the frameworks and the lessons that I've learned work for others? And so that's what, and I would say, find somebody to help, right? Do it for free, do a beta or whatever you want to call it, but see if your methods work for other people. And that's how you get clarity on who you're helping and how you can help them. So for me, it was in podcast form for a long time, right? I was just interviewing other successful entrepreneurs, asking them about their business and their marriage and how they integrated. And so then I started to put together the frameworks, right? And then I started testing my frameworks on other people. And when I found that they were helping others, then I was like, okay, I know I want to help entrepreneurs who are married stay happily married while they build their empire without having to sacrifice anything that's important to them. So my message, my clarity, it just got dialed in as I went.
Yeah, yeah. That is so important. And I know we can go a long time through the rabbit hole of marketing and talking about all these things, but I really want to transition the conversation a little bit towards marriage relationships.
Before we go there, because like obviously this is the episode, this is a selfish episode, this is just for me, so I can surprise Katie later. Anyways, no, I'm kidding, this is for everybody. But you keep, like, before we go there, you keep bringing the word frameworks, right? For us, and especially now for me, like I'm the integrator. I feel like a lot of people describe me as the integrator in the business. You know, Fonsi is the dreamer, the explorer, the, you know, the good idea guy. And then, you know, I'm the scrappy dude in the back.
Someone has to do the work.
Someone has to do the work, right? And for me, frameworks was a massive clarity moment last year at Fun Hacking Live.
Yeah.
Because Russell was explaining frameworks. And I didn't quite understand that then. Now that I'm in the business, like, we literally base everything off a framework. And I think Alex Sharfin, he published it the other day. It's like, do not ever make a decision without a framework, right? And we recently had a call like 2 days ago with this amazing service provider that, because we implement on frameworks, this solution is wonderful. It fits the purpose. Amazing, right? So can you help us understand a little bit, in your words, what is the framework and how you discovered that? Because I feel like that's such an important piece of on any business, right? On the product that you sell, there's a framework how you produce that. On a service that you deliver, there's a framework on how you deliver that. On a course, on an information piece that you share, there's a framework behind each of our episodes. There's a framework on how we produce the episode. So can you explain to us a little bit, like, because you keep bringing it up, right? So I'm very curious, what is your view on frameworks and how you discover yours?
Yeah. Well, so the difference between having a framework and not having a framework is, once you have a framework, then the process is repeatable, right? You can teach it to somebody and they can implement it in steps so that it makes sense. So that's what a framework is to me. It's just a repeatable process that gets results for multiple people. So that would be my definition of a framework. And in relationships, it's, everybody's relationship looks a little bit different, right? But there are certain skills and frameworks and strategies that, when you put them into place, they are repeatable and they will get results every single time.
That's interesting. And so you mentioned marriage right now, and I'm curious because I'm thinking, because sometimes I take my business mind to my relationship, and I'm like, yeah, maybe we should have a framework for some of these conversations, right? And the answer I get is like, that takes the magic away, right? That might take the magic away of spontaneity. I don't know if that's the correct word. Yeah, that's a tough one for us. But yeah, like I've encountered that, right? It's like, okay, like I want something that doesn't have to have a mental weight of creating a decision, try to figure out every single time from scratch, instead of we've had, you know, tackle situation like this in the past. What is the framework to solve this? Let's go ahead and do it, right? So what would you say to those people that are talking about, you know, like it loses that magic touch, I guess, in their relationship?
Yeah, I definitely don't think frameworks take away the spontaneity. In fact, it makes it better, right? Because we all have patterns of interaction, right? We all fall into patterns, habits, in the way we relate to each other and with our family, right? And when we start to recognize those patterns, see, I think where people get in trouble is where they just kind of think it's fine. Everything's fine. Like, you know, we may be getting in a fight, or we may be doing this or that, but everything is just, it's fine. They don't look at their relationship and the patterns that they're naturally falling into. When you start to apply frameworks and you start to become aware of the natural patterns that are just there in your relationship, it gives you so much freedom to be creative with all of these new ways. Like, hey, like, let's take the bedroom, for example, because I do call myself an intimacy expert, right? So in the bedroom, if you notice that you're falling into this same pattern of intimacy over and over and over again, right? You can look at it and you can set up a new way to get to experiment and get creative and make things fun and exciting again. And you don't have to plan what you're going to do every time, but you can plan for that time to connect. And then you know that it's coming, and you can get excited, and you can be creative, and you can switch things up. And you know that you're both on the same page with looking for fun and exciting new ways to experience something that you're doing together for the next 50 years, right? Like, how boring would it be to just fall into a rut and do the same thing over and over and over again with the same person for 50 years? That would be really boring. But you can apply some really fun frameworks to it so that you can have more freedom to explore and be creative within those frameworks. So, yeah, so definitely do not think that ruins the spontaneity.
That's so good. That is the reason I asked this question, is so I can clip it and send it to my girlfriend.
You know, the way I picture, right, I'm a very visual person, right? So I picture like these little capsules, right? So, you know, the intimacy capsule, right? So where are we placing that intimacy capsule? You know, is it at 7 at night? You know, once the baby's done, like, poof, this is our time now inside of that capsule. Let's play and do something else, right? Now, the argument capsule, right? Okay, what happens? Like, how do I actually tackle the conversation in my argument capsule, right? How can I better? So there's no argument capsule anymore, right? Like, how are those things, right? And I feel like for me, that has helped me big time. You know, earlier we were actually chatting, like on the drive here to the studio, that on how Fonzie approaches a conversation now, that I was like, oh my God, that's an incredible framework I'm about to start implementing, right? It's like, hey, you know, if I personally have the issue, right, where somebody tells me something, I am very quick to give my opinion, right? So that has caused some issues at home, where my wife's like, stop, I just want to like talk to you about and not have to listen to your feedback, right? I tend to do that. And the second that she communicated that with me, I recognize it, right? But now what Fonzie has said, and if I butcher it, Fonzie, you can correct me, but it's like, hey, you know, it's, do you want me to give you my opinion, or do you want me to listen? And he's like, dude, it's been great. And I'm like, oh my God, sweet. Share more. Let's do it. So that's potentially a framework, right, for that type of conversations, right? So then we grab these little capsules and then we put them in times and places to continue to execute. Am I right? Is that visual correct?
Yeah, that's perfect. That's amazing.
Good job. You're on the right path. I'm proud of you. You know,
I implement now, but I execute. There's no success without execution.
Yeah. Monica, something I've noticed throughout my life, and again, for people here listening, I'm not married. I'm in a relationship. But, you know, I feel like my emotions are so tied to my performance, right?
Oh, sorry,
in
that was not it.
Every single aspect of my life. When I was little, my goal was just be a professional soccer player. So when I remember clearly when I would like fall in love with a girl and she wouldn't pay attention to me and I was like struggle emotionally, I would play terrible soccer games. Yeah. And now it happens the same in business. When I have issues in my relationship, I can definitely, and my brother can attest to this, see it at the office, right? Like when I have to work, I'm like not very productive. Why do you think that is? I know it takes part of my brain power because I'm like thinking of that and all that stuff, but how can we, and people that are listening, if they find themselves in the same situation, how can they move past this, right? Or what do we need to talk it out with our partners immediately? Should we wait some time? And again, this question is totally selfish because I want to perform 100% in the office and in my relationship. I'm going to rephrase that. I want to perform 100% first in my relationship, right? And then in the business. I'm curious, right? Because I don't want to have those feelings. It's so conflicting.
I cannot confirm or deny that this happened, but you know, when Fonzie, that they had a little break, those 3 months, it's like only Luis that was working. It was completely horrible. So please, Monica, we need you for this.
Well, let me try to answer those in order. So the first thing you asked was, why do I think that is? I think that happens because we are emotional creatures wired for connection, right? So our number one need is to connect with humans, right? I mean, that's how we're wired. And so when things are not like jiving on all cylinders at home in our most interpersonal relationships, it makes it very difficult to perform in any other area, right? So there's been thousands and thousands of studies that talk about how the number one predictor of happiness and success in life is the quality of your most intimate relationship. So your marriage or your relationship, right? So that's why someone like me would exist. And you ask, so like, what can you do, right? That is a little bit different for everyone, but you can learn what your patterns are, how you interact with your significant other. And then you can start to just up-level them, right? You can apply these strategies and frameworks that I teach to up-level that relationship. So I never promise anyone that there aren't going to be challenges. Of course, there's going to be challenges in marriage, life, and business, right? That's just how life is. But what I can promise you is that when you understand how to apply these things, then you never worry about those struggles. It's like you can face all of your challenges head on together as a team, knowing that the struggle is going to make you stronger, right? And so you just have a different perspective on it. Like, hey, I know the tough times are going to come because that's life, but we can handle any tough time that comes together. We're going to get through it. And so that is really like what I'm all about, is teaching you the skills, strategies, and frameworks to just take life as it comes, take the challenge as it comes, but take them with confidence that you're going to face them together as a team and get through them together stronger.
Ah, that's so good. And I think this feeds off the conversation that we're having the other day at Clubhouse. I think this is the first interaction that I had with you. And I think this was along the lines of my question, right? Like, so along our journey, and I've seen this in other entrepreneurs, still people that we chat that are in a similar space, right? Like for us last year was probably our most growth year. Like it was like the amount of personal growth that we had, not just from publishing, but from experiences that we had in our business, experiences that we had with our clients, with our partners. Like it just like, it was literally, you good, Fonzie, there?
Sorry, I got scared. Then my brain started moving and I got scared.
But it's sorry, like bro. Literally a piece of wood named growth hits us in the face, right? And then after that, you're like, okay, I feel like I'm at this level, right? And then sometimes we might feel that our partner may not be keeping up, like on their side with that growth pattern, right? Because we're my partner, right, Katie, she's not an entrepreneur, right? And maybe she is, I don't know, but she doesn't practice entrepreneurship, right? She's a pharmacist, completely different. She's perfectly happy at her job. He loves it. She loves it. She has a lot of time with her son, right? But I don't, what I, the, the way I see it from my point of view is she's not faced with the challenges that I'm probably facing every single day, right? So my growth rate might be a little bit different than hers, and then hence there's a little bit of a disconnect, right? So what is the advice there, right, for people that might be feeling the same way? Because I've heard both. I've heard people that kind of level up the same way and they have a great communication and or they have agreements and frameworks to work their relationship. But I've also heard people that literally go further apart and then their relationship might end, right? So what is some advice if we are in that space where, hey, I feel like I'm growing, I don't feel like you're growing. And again, you know, yeah, that, what is the advice there? Like, what can people do to make sure that we're on the same page?
Yeah. So the first thing I would make sure that we understood was growth looks different for everyone, right? So get really excited about entrepreneurial growth, like learning things in masterminds and content creation. And that's all so you get really passionate and excited about it, right? But for her, she probably gets really passionate and excited about something that your son did or, you know, something like that, right? And so you're both, for the record, growing constantly, but being able to share that growth looks a little bit different. So if you're really excited about this new deal that you signed or something, you can talk about the details of that with Fonzie, how exciting that you guys get to work together and be passionate about content creation together, right? So that's fantastic. But what you can share with Katie is your feelings about it, right? So oh my gosh, work is just so energizing and exciting. And she might say something like, what is so energizing and exciting about it, right? You don't have to give her the details about signing this big account or figuring out this new framework, but you can be like, I feel like I'm growing in these ways and these ways. And I'm willing to bet that she would be really interested to know how you feel like you're growing, what you're most excited about, what makes you nervous, places in which you feel like maybe there's a weakness there or something. And I bet she'd be willing to share her, takeaways in growth in life as a mom and as a pharmacist and, with you. So I think creating a shared vision so that you both know that you're growing towards the same thing, but in very different ways is going to be really important, right? So this is our vision for our family. This is how my business fits into that vision. Here's how, being a dad and a mom and how we handle our money and the time that we spend together. That's how all of these things fit into this big vision. And then constantly be checking in with each other. How are we doing? Is what I'm doing in my business working so that we're getting closer to our vision? Is how we're supporting each other in the different areas of our life, is that working towards our vision, right? So when you get to the top of that mountain, you're standing there together. So maybe even, you took a different route to get there, you're there together.
Oh, that's so good. And thank you for that, right? Yeah. Thank you for we don't know what we don't know, right? And I saw, for example, before you answered that question to me on Clubhouse and now here, right? I hope this nails it to a lot of people that are listening, right? Because for me, in my perspective, I saw growth because the way that I was experiencing it through the business, right? So I assumed, and you know, this is one of the things that we tell everybody, never assume, right? I assumed that was the way, and what you just explained brought a ton of clarity. So I'm taking that home with me. And same thing, right? She is experiencing growth in different ways, but at the same time, we could potentially talk about, the feelings in between and how that full picture can take us both up there. So I appreciate you that you completely changed my perspective on growth together with my couple. So I thank you for that. And I hope you did that for a lot of people listening too.
Yeah, I love the concept of the shared vision, growing together, even if you both are growing in different ways. Right. And to go back to my brother's comment, when he was talking about it, a thought that came into my mind was ego, right? We are creatures of ego, sadly, right? And we need to sometimes disconnect from that ego, but we are I'm growing faster than the other person in my relationship. How do we, how do we disconnect from that? How do we accept that the other person is growing at a different rate and maybe in a different direction, right? And that's why I love the shared vision, because then it's like, okay, let's kind of like regroup and talk about it. But how do you go about disconnecting yourself from that ego so you stop seeing that growth as a competition?
Yeah. Okay. I love that question. And this is like a little bit of a higher level strategy I'm about to give you. But I have this equation that I teach all my students, and it's curiosity plus vulnerability equals creativity, right? So like the beautiful thing about marriage is you have the opportunity to create your own world, your own life together, right? You create these children together. You create a shared vision together. You create the environment in your home. You're creating together, but you both have very different parts in this creative process, right? Men and women are very different. And, you know, entrepreneurs and non-entrepreneurs, very different, right? And so what's going to be most important is if you can be curious about your partner and you can be vulnerable about your own growth, then you can create this shared vision. And so if you remember that you're always headed towards that same vision that you're creating together, it doesn't matter who's going faster or slower or who's doing this or that, right? You're going to stay very curious about each other and you're going to be very vulnerable with each other. And that's how you create an incredible shared vision, home environment, you know, synergy between the two of you. That's
amazing. Ooh, I love this. Can we dig deeper? Do you mind if we like dig deeper into each one of these? Because when you tell me about being curious about my partner, right? I personally, I'm like, I feel like I know everything that there is to be about my partner. And I feel a lot of people might think that way too. Yeah. How do we, you know, tap deeper into that curiosity, and what are ways to, you know, make them feel safe to share some of the things that we're curious about?
Okay, let me give you something very, very concrete here. And it's what I call daily connections. And so when you say, like, I feel like I know everything about my partner, oh man, you couldn't possibly, right? If you're growing every single day in lots of different ways, there's no possible way she knows everything. Even if you spend every minute of every day together, I guarantee you're experiencing things differently, right? So this works for any couple in any situation. I call it daily connections. So there's 1,440 minutes in a day. And what I teach my students is that they should be spending 20 minutes of that 1,440. So that leaves 1,420 minutes to do anything you want. But 20 minutes should be about connecting with each other. And here's where it's non-negotiable. Okay. You're going to make sure that this happens every single day, and you're going to take away all distractions. So, you know, there's different times of day that works for different couples, right? So it might be a walk after dinner. It might be after the children go to bed. It might be very first thing in the morning when you first wake up, but I want you to focus on connecting through curiosity. So I want you to ask each other questions like, what's exciting to you right now? What are you most looking forward to? What's difficult for you right now? What are you feeling insecure about? How can I help you become the person you're meant to become, right? Those types of questions where you're figuring out not just like, how was your day? What did you do today? It's like, what are you experiencing inside? Like, what are you so looking forward to right now? Like, is there something that just gets you going right now? Are you feeling a little sluggish? Like, what is it that you're really experiencing, and how can I be a part of making that better? So that's the curiosity part. So you're going to start with curiosity, and then you're going to be vulnerable, because then your partner gets to ask you questions like that. And so instead of being like, oh, I'm doing good, everything's good, I'm growing in my business, right? You're going to be like, oh man, like we have this one client, and every time I talk to him, I don't know. I feel like things are crazy, right? You're just going to open up and be vulnerable. Or you're going to be like, every time I go to this mastermind meeting, I'm so charged and I'm so stoked for everything we're going to accomplish, right? You tell them the things that excite you. You tell them the things that that scare you. You tell them the things you're insecure about. You tell them the things that you feel like you're growing, right? You're sharing what's inside of you. So you take turns being curious and vulnerable. And that's how you create this incredible connection that's going to allow you to do anything you set your mind to as a couple.
Ah, so good. This is quickly becoming a relationship mastermind of just this episode. So,
I'll let you ask the next question. I just want to make a connection here for the audience, because a few episodes ago, we talked about the 1% investing rule, which for those that are not familiar with it, investor James Altucher, he said he doesn't invest in anything more than 1% of his net worth, right? And then we're talking to somebody else about activities in your life and taking on new activities, hobbies, whatever you want. And we talked like, wow, what if we approach that with the 1% rule? Don't invest, right, more than 1% of your time in a task a day, right? So if it doesn't work, you can put it aside. I'm not saying that the relationship is not going to work, but to put this into perspective, 1% of your day is like 14.7 minutes, which is like 15 minutes, right? So 15 minutes of your day. So literally 20 minutes of your day is like 1.2, 1.3% of your day that you have to invest in probably what is the most valuable aspect of your life, which is your relationship. Because I'm going to tie this to what you said earlier, which is the studies, right? That success is tied to the quality of the most intimate relationships that we have. So if we can invest at least, like, just put it in this way, how easy it is for us to invest 1% of our day into what is going to give us the biggest dividends over time, which is the quality of our relationship. So thank you so much, Monica.
That's so good, Fancy. I see some like smoke coming out of your ear.
I had some good coffee before this conversation.
That was good. So I also want to make another connection, not as good as Fancy, but I think like this framework, you can apply it not only on your home relationship, in every single relationship, because as you were explaining it, right, yesterday Fancy is like, let's have a walk, right, outside. We go outside and sometimes our conversation flows naturally that way. And it's like, hey, you know, I'm feeling this way. I'm struggling with this way. And then the conversation flows and then the creativity comes and we're like, oh man, we have these amazing solutions and the relationship improves, right? Naturally, it's been happening between both of us, which is great, right? So, you know, people are listening now that you have business partners or people in your office or people that you work with, practice this in there, right? Not only in your marriage, but this, like, this is a wonderful, powerful framework that you could utilize for 20 minutes a day. And it's going to get those results that you explained, Monica, and that Fancy was illustrating. So I also want to make that connection, right? Like we are in relationships most of the time. So thank you for sharing that. Now I'm going to play a little bit devil's advocate here after that comment, right? It's like, okay, it could be on your, with your wife or husband or in your business, right? If that one person is kind of reluctant of going or investing 20 minutes with you, right? What are some tips and things that we could do to actually start doing this, right? Because if we don't have the 20 minutes with them, we cannot be curious and vulnerable, right? So what are some things that we can do for that business partner? So Fancy, you know, sometimes he has to convince me to go out on a walk and sometimes I'm like, nope, I gotta get work done, man. So what are those steps? Like, how do people go about that?
That's a really interesting question. I feel like I've been asked that question in like funny ways, but never so directly as you just asked it. So like one time somebody, like I worked with a couple and she was like, I'm very type A. And so I like to plan things. And my husband is very not that way. Like he just likes to be spontaneous, kind of like Fonzie was talking about. Like, so how can I have this non-negotiable 20 minutes, right? And so I was like, okay, well, if you're the planner, you're in charge of the calendar, right? So you can say, hey, honey, we are after dinner, we're going to be taking a walk. And you can plan anything you want anytime around that. But I just want to make sure that you know that after dinner, I get 20 minutes, we're going to take a walk and it's going to be amazing, right? So if you're more type A, if you're kind of the planner and your spouse is just kind of fly by the seat of their pants, you just control the schedule and you just invite them along, right? If they're resistant to it, like I like the only thing I can think of is like maybe like a child who like you, you're like, you know, we're going to do this thing right now and they don't want to. I think that you just find creative ways to make it a good experience for both of you. So if that means like, hey, we're going to go take a drive and we'll go grab your favorite soft drink at, you know, the drive-through or whatever, like just find creative ways to get your 20 minutes in. Like it could be like, hey, like I got us our favorite show and I'm going to queue it up and then we're going to spend 20 minutes and we're just going to chat and then we'll turn on our favorite show or whatever. Yeah. Or like I videotaped the Super Bowl for you or whatever. I'm like so excited. I just want to chat with you for a few minutes and then we'll get it started. Whatever it is, just find a way to kind of sneak it in if they're not super willing to do that.
I love that, you know, and I would love to see what people are trying to do, right? Because, you know, I can see it, right? Like sometimes we might not be in the mood or, you know, we might not even like we inside of the business, right? Sometimes can be stressful, right? And you're like, I don't really want to talk about this, right? But we feel like personally, I feel like when I put it out, right, to the world, to like write it down or discuss it, things flow a little bit more easily. So I've started to realize that that's really good for me, right? But for the longest time, we haven't done it. A quick example here and being super transparent, here in the business, you know, Fonsi has been chasing me for months. Like, dude, we need like a weekly meeting. Like we used to have him. What happened now? Like in my head, I'm like, oh man, we're just so busy with execution. I just need to like get this done. And then we go there. Right. And then for the last 2 weeks, we've actually sat outside in a different environment and done this. And this is kind of like our way in our relationship to go about these things. And there's been some progress, right? So like,
thank you. Hug it out. Really important distinction though, because having your weekly meetings, like you just said, to kind of air it out, that's different than 20 minute connection, right? You don't want to bring up like, hey, I feel like we're growing apart, or hey, like you know, absolutely, whatever. Yeah, those things you want to definitely hold on to and have a weekly meeting that's kind of like that. And here's my advice about those weekly meetings. I would do that in an environment, definitely not your bedroom, right? So if you're going to have like a weekly air it out, like here's what's going well, here's what's not going well or whatever, definitely don't do that in your bedroom. I like to, if you can go out, if you can take a drive, if you can go to a restaurant, I mean, at the very least, go into your office and do have that kind of a discussion. But those are really, really important. And it's also really important to have that established. So that way you're not picking at each other all the time. Like, I hate it when you load the dishwasher this way, or you know, I feel like, you know, you're constantly leaving your clothes on the floor, right? So if you're gonna have like that type of discussion, have a weekly meeting. Like, let's get together, let's talk about our shared vision and how things are going towards that shared vision, right? But the 20 minutes is just like, hey, all of that aside, what's going on inside of you? Like, how can we connect? And you don't want to do this in your weekly meeting with Fonzie, but in your weekly meeting with Katie, you're going to end the meeting with some form of physical affection, meaning a kiss or a hug or a back rub or some physical representation that you've connected.
Just definitely not with Fonzie. It's not happening with
Fonzie. High fives.
Very good.
I love it. Oh, I feel you that you're not only helping us big time, but you're helping a lot of the audience, right? Because this is something that most people don't talk about, right? In the business side of things, it's so important. You know, like Fonzie mentioned earlier, you know, when that's not going well, nothing's getting done in the office, right? So, and I feel like he might not be the only one feeling that way. You know, I certainly felt that way before, and I'm sure everybody listening right now have felt that way before. So, Monica, thank you so much for everything that you've shared today. I mean, we could potentially continue talking like this so much more.
Before we go into the last couple of questions, I do want to make a little remark on what you said about environment, because that is so key, right? And remember reading, I think it was Highly Successful Habits, something like that, from Brendan Burchard. And he talks about this, that your body has a memory of its own. And when you enter a room, pretty much like you start remembering things and it changes things. So if you start having these discussions in the bedroom, right, then the next time you start coming to the bedroom, your body's going to get triggered on, oh, this is where we had the discussions. And immediately your emotional level just like either drops, right? So I love this about hey, let's look for a different environment to have these conversations. Let's look for, you know, certain type of environments where it can be safe for us to have a discussion, a healthy discussion, and then don't bring it into the house where we spend the most time, because we don't want to relate that with, you know, fightings or whatever, right? Negative emotions. So thank you so much. I think it's very, very important that, again, connecting it to the business world, I think it can be applied to the business as well, right? I think that's why we enjoy having our conversations outside, where here in Florida it doesn't get that cold. So it's pretty nice.
Pretty nice.
Yeah, but thank you, Monica. I really appreciate that.
All right, Monica, last couple questions to wrap up the show. What will be your number one? I mean, the episode has been full of action points, like as usual, but it's like your number one action point for, you know, that type of person that we've been talking about all day. Like, we have that relationship. Maybe it's not 100% there, but they have their business. They're working really hard, you know, hustling every single day to make it happen, right? What is the number one thing that they can do at home, right, to start that momentum or continue that positive momentum?
Ooh, gosh, there's so many good things. So many. Like,
So here's the thing. We can just tell us one, and then we'll send people to find out all the others with you.
Okay, great, great, great. So I think the one thing, and it sounds so cliche because everybody talks about it, but date night is the most important. So if you're doing your 20-minute daily connections and you're making sure that you have a date night, that's how you ensure that you never, ever, ever get too busy to focus on your relationship. So date nights are 3 hours a week, non-negotiable, and they should be something fun that you both enjoy doing together. So it can't be something that's focused around your business, something that's focused around your kids, something that's focused around finances. You definitely don't want to have that air it out conversation there. Date night is just for connection and fun. So you connect emotionally. I want you to connect physically. And if you're doing that once a week in conjunction with your daily connections, you're going to ensure that no matter how busy and crazy things get, that you're constantly connected.
So good.
So in my relationship, I cannot go play bowling as a date night because my girlfriend doesn't like bowling. Noted, Monica. Noted. Thank you.
Once in a while, bowling is, it can be fun, even if she doesn't want it. You want to make sure that you're doing things that she equally enjoys.
Yeah, no, definitely. I was joking. And I love that, right? Because I feel especially I have been doing a pretty poor job at date night, right? And I'm going to give you an example. Yesterday, I texted her. I'm like, babe, what are you doing tomorrow night? And she's like, well, I don't have anything planned. And I'm like, good, we can grab a pokeball from the place that we always eat. And I'm like, and then we can eat at the house. And she was like, oh, no. Her answer was like, oh, I thought we were going to do something different. And I was like, you know what? Like, I actually could have put more thought into it. And she's like, I thought you were going to ask me to like go out to eat at somewhere and stuff like that. So I was like, okay, we can do that. Like, let's go eat at this other restaurant that you like eating. So now we have a date night and we're going to go eat over there. So, but I like the fact that it's like, let's plan it out. Do you recommend having like a specific date every single week, like Fridays afternoon, or how do you guys plan it out in your relationship, for example?
Yeah. So for us, we have a solid Friday night date night. However, we do have kids, and so like tonight we've got basketball games, so we'll either go out after the basketball game or we'll go out tomorrow night. So it's you definitely have to make changes or whatever, but our kids know that we go out on a date every weekend. So there's never like a question of like, are mom and dad going out this weekend? Like, we always are going out. So that's the idea behind planning it and making it like solidified, but you've got to roll with the punches of life, right? If you've got four kids that are all in different activities, you got to be creative. Yeah. Sometimes you have a middle of the day date night, so whatever.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Yes.
I feel like this episode just boosted my relationship of the sky. Thank you.
I know, that's incredible. Monica, where will you be if you did not publish?
Say that again. Where would I be if I didn't publish?
Yeah.
Well, I certainly would not be here or like speaking to you with the confidence that I'm speaking to you with. I think publishing is what helps me find my voice. And I think the most important thing to remember about publishing is don't compare yourself to anyone else, right? Everybody starts at the beginning. Everybody gets stuck in the messy middle. And so it doesn't matter who you are or how you started, but just keep going.
Ah, that's so good.
Yeah, that is a very powerful advice.
Yes.
Wow, so wise. Thank you.
Thank you. Monica, where can people find you? Where can people connect with you?
Yeah, so you can find me at www.onthebrightersideofmarriage.com. That will link you to my podcast and all the other places where you can find me. But I do really like Instagram, and my handle there is at MoniTanner1.
Perfect.
Awesome. Can you repeat the website one more time?
www.onthebrightersideofmarriage.com.
Yes. Perfect. If you're listening, just scroll down. All the links are going to be right there. Just like tap it, connect, guys. Like, this was such a cool thing. Go listen to Monica on her show. Go to her website. Like, dig deep. Go there. Go have your 20-minute connecting date nights. I'm definitely putting that in my to-dos, like, or not to-dos, my do's of every week with Katie. I'm sure, like, she's going to be super happy, and I can't wait to give you some updates, Monica.
I'm looking forward to actually share this episode with my girlfriend, like, babe, you got to listen to this. We got to implement. We got to take action. We got to have frameworks in the relationship. It's going to be so much fun.
So good. Again, how she feels, not about the framework. Sorry, how she feels.
I know.
Right, Monica? We got it right. Okay. Awesome. Awesome. Monica, any last thoughts that we might have missed?
I don't think so. Like, reach out. If you have questions. I'm really accessible, and I love to chat. So,
yes.
And as you can tell, she is incredibly friendly as well. So definitely reach out to her.
Yes. All right, guys. With that being said, thank you so much for tuning into the Content Sprout Podcast. Go ahead and subscribe. Hit smash that subscribe button and follow us on social media at Beast Bros Co.
That is right. And if you find this episode impactful and you believe it's going to take your marriage to the next level, please don't forget to share it and leave a 5-star review. Thank you.
Bye, guys.
All right.
Monica, we're still live on Facebook. Thank you so much. I know we ran out like five minutes after the hour.
Yes, and
you probably have
kiddos.
Oh no!
Quick selfie. Sorry. Here we go.
Take 2 seconds.
1, 2, 3. Awesome. Bye, Facebook.